United Methodist Church. As we continue to work through some technical difficulties with the broadcast, we appreciate your patience. Those of you that are watching with us on Facebook Live, we welcome you as well. It is a beautiful morning. Summer has come with a vengeance yesterday with those strong south winds and hot temperatures, and so welcome to spring in Iowa. I've been doing a lot of walking lately. I think all of you know that we are now the parents of two dogs. I may have my head on a platter for that someday, I'm not really sure, but it does get me out walking and enjoying the sunshine a lot more. And as the PowerPoint slides are showing today, just the apple trees in blossom are so beautiful. Campus is beautiful, the neighborhood is beautiful, there's just so much to enjoy. And I've been trying to take a little bit of a break from the craziness of life and just enjoy the beauty around me. And took me to a Revelation chapter 4, verse 11. Worthy are you, O Lord and God, to receive glory and honor and power, for you created all things, and by your will they existed and were created. I don't know how anyone can look at the beauty of just these blossoms and not believe in a God who designed this world for us to enjoy. So this morning we will open with number 92 in the hymnal. Number 92, this is for the beauty of the earth, for the things that we have to rejoice over in creation and in one another and in the gift of Jesus, God's Son. Number 92. We'll do verses 1, 2, 5, and 6. Thank you, church. We do indeed have reason to have a hymn of grateful praise on our lips this morning. Our scripture lesson today, we will finish up chapter 4 of Peter's first letter to the persecuted church. This is 1 Peter 4, verses 12 through the end of the chapter, which is verse 19. Beloved, do not be surprised at the fiery trial when it comes upon you to test you, as though something strange were happening to you. But rejoice in so far as you share Christ's sufferings, that you may also rejoice and be glad when his glory is revealed. If you are insulted for the name of Christ, you are blessed, because the Spirit of glory and of God rests upon you. But let none of you suffer as a murderer, or a thief, or an evildoer, or as a meddler. Yet if anyone suffers as a Christian, let him not be ashamed, but let him glorify God in that name. For it is time for judgment to begin at the household of God. And if it begins with us, what will be the outcome for those who do not obey the gospel of God? And if the righteous is scarcely saved, what will become of the ungodly and the sinner? Therefore, let those who suffer according to God's will entrust their souls to a faithful Creator while doing good. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
So far, Christians in the United States of America have not had to face severe trials. We might have experienced some ridicule here and there, and even some restriction of our religious liberties, but by and large, we have not faced persecution like people throughout the world and throughout history have often faced. There might be a couple of reasons for that. First, and perhaps most obvious, is that religious liberty is written into our Constitution. Within certain limits, anyone is free to practice their religion, any religion, without hindrance. The second possible reason is that we haven't faced severe persecution in this world, in this country, is that we have watered down our faith. We have blended in with our culture to such an extent that people can't tell the difference between those who are Christians and those who are not Christians. Our beliefs and our practices do not distinguish us. We are shaped more by our culture than we are being salt and light to our culture. And so when you think about it, why should anybody persecute us if we're acting just like they do? I believe that things may be about to change. Even now, our culture is turning up the heat on Christians. Preaching on what the Bible teaches about certain topics is considered hate speech. Standing up for your religious convictions will get you labeled as intolerant, bigoted, or even worse. The message from our culture is becoming clearer. Shut up, compromise, and then get with the program. Blend in with your surroundings. Bible makes it clear that Christians will be tested, some more severely than others. It appears in our scripture passage this morning that the Apostle Peter warns us that a fiery trial is coming. We must not let it take us by surprise. We must be ready for it. We must not allow the prospect of persecution to lead us to compromise our faith, to make us do that. So if you haven't already done so, I invite you to open your Bibles to 1 Peter 4, 12 through 19, to see the encouragement that God has for us as we face our fiery trial. Peter begins this section of his letter with a startling claim in verse 12. Beloved, do not be surprised at the fiery trial when it comes upon you to test you as though something strange were happening to you. Now, I say this is startling because Christians in our culture today generally tend to think that when we become Christians, our troubles should be over. We shouldn't have any problems. We shouldn't have any testings. We should be protected. It should be a smooth sailing from here on out. After all, our expectations are shaped really by Psalm 23, aren't they? We want to be led into green pastures and still waters. We want to see food-laden tables and overflowing cups. We want to have tranquility. We didn't sign up for fiery trials. But if you're living as a Christian without compromise, fiery trials are going to come. You may remember that Peter was writing this letter to Christians in a context not unlike our own. The Christians in Asia Minor were transplanted. They were resident aliens. And they're surrounded by a polytheistic culture, which in a sense was good news. That meant that what's one more God will allow you to worship your God as we worship our God, as long as you don't make us feel bad about worshiping our God, as long as you don't make any exclusive claims about your God being better than everybody else. So when Peter wrote this letter, he had probably had a specific fiery trial in mind that was coming. He didn't have in mind any fiery trial that would be approaching us. He was probably thinking, depending on when this letter was actually written, he may have been thinking of the fiery trial that would come under Nero. Nero literally set Christians on fire. He persecuted them. It was a fiery trial. So it may have been this particular trial that he had in mind for his original audience. Now, I think that speaks to people today too. The certainty of the fiery trial is not the only thing that startles us here. Not only is the fiery trial certain, but it also has a purpose. What's the purpose? It's to test you. The fiery trial that was about to come upon the Christians in Asia Minor, and may be about to come upon us, is not a random, senseless act, something that just happens. It is a purposeful act. And that purpose is to test you. Immediately, our minds leap to a question. Who is doing the testing? And what is the reason for the test? What is the purpose for it? Well, as a former teacher, I am perfectly aware of the fact that teachers, I think all teachers, give tests at one time or another. And we don't administer tests because we just love doing tests. We administer tests to measure the amount of knowledge that students have attained. So there was a person administering the test. There's a reason for the test. In the case of the fiery trials we have as Christians, it is God who is ultimately administering the test, not our persecutors. We tend to focus on the people who are persecuting us, and we think that God is just nowhere around, that God is unable to stop it. But we should be encouraged to know that it's God who ultimately is administering the test. Because as the one who administers the test, God sets the boundaries for that test. It goes this far and no farther. You can test my people, but you can't take them beyond the point where they suffer, to the point where they lose their life. Oh yeah, you can kill their body, but they will not lose their life. They will remain alive in me, God says. So God governs our suffering. He doesn't allow it to go beyond the means that we have to get through the test. But why? Why does God allow this fiery trial? What is the reason for it? Well, God does not send or permit the fiery trial because he loves seeing his children suffer. Neither does he allow it to see who his followers are. Because God knows everything. God knows who his followers are. God knows how far we will go. So why does he test us? Well, I think he allows the fiery trial so that we will learn how far we can go. We will learn how serious we are about following Christ. For instance, we may believe in theory that we are prepared for danger. We know what to do if somebody collapses next to us or a fire breaks out in our home. We may know how we'll react if there's a burning building and there's a child inside. But we won't know actually how we will work until we actually face that. It's the test. We don't stand on theory. We stand on what we know will happen. So those who persevere and hold on to their faith pass the test, and they receive their reward. As James 1:12 puts it, blessed is the man who remains steadfast under trial, for when he has stood the test, he will receive the crown of life, which God has promised to those who love him. So that's when he has passed the test, he'll receive the crown of glory. So the fiery trial that we experience turns out to be a blessing. That's how we can do what James tells us, or what Peter tells us in verse 13. But rejoice insofar as you share Christ's sufferings, that you may also rejoice and be glad when his glory is revealed. It's not the suffering itself that should cause us to rejoice. We're not masochists. We don't love suffering. We don't seek it out. But we rejoice in our suffering. We rejoice because of what our suffering produces or what our suffering reveals. If we are suffering unjustly as a Christian, we are identifying with Jesus. We are sharing in his sufferings. And if we share in Christ's sufferings, then we will also share in his glory. This is vividly mentioned in Romans 8, chapter 8, verses 16 and 17. It says, the Spirit himself bears witness with our spirit that we are children of God, and if children, then heirs. Heirs of God and fellow heirs with Christ, provided we suffer with him in order that we may also be glorified with him. We participate in his suffering, and we also participate in his glory. So that should cause us to rejoice. We're undergoing this fiery trial. We're identifying with Jesus, who underwent his fiery trial. So it's not the suffering we rejoice in, it's the goal beyond the suffering, glory. So the fiery trial helps to confirm in us that we are really Christ's, that we belong to him. So Peter is consoling us. He's consoling us that it is better to stand by our faith now, even though it leads to suffering, than to deny Christ so that the suffering ends. When you consider who is writing this letter, it's very poignant, isn't it? Think about Peter. What happened? What happened on the night that Jesus was betrayed and arrested? He denied him 3 times. For some reason, he thought, I don't want to go through what suffering might be in store, so I'm going to deny Jesus. I think you learn from experience how agonizing that is. And he was forgiven, wasn't he? He denied Christ 3 times, and Jesus, after he rose from the dead, allowed him to commit himself to Jesus 3 times. It's true that when we suffer, we tend to wonder if we are being punished by God. Doesn't that thought go through your mind? Whenever something bad happens, we think, why is God doing this to us? Why is he punishing us? Why is he allowing this to happen? God doesn't want us to think about suffering as punishment here. Verse 14 reads, "If you are insulted for the name of Christ, you are blessed, because the Spirit of glory and of God rests upon you. Not you will be blessed, but you are blessed." That's his point here. The blessing is that the Spirit of glory and of God rests upon those who choose to suffer rather than to cave in to their culture's pressure to sin by compromising their faith or rejecting Christ. It is the Spirit's power, the Holy Spirit's power, working in us and through us that enables us to stand up against the fiery trial. Enables us to be steadfast in our faith. It enables us to stand firm in our convictions and our values. Those who willingly suffer rather than compromise are demonstrating that the Spirit is in them. The Spirit is working in them, producing a conviction, a power that is able to withstand the fiery trial. In verse 15, Peter warns us to examine ourselves and to make sure that we are not suffering because of bad behavior. He wants to make sure that we're not suffering because we deserve it. It's unjust suffering that produces glory. Verse 15 says, "But let none of you suffer as a murderer or a thief or an evildoer or as a meddler." In other words, don't live in such a way that society can justly condemn you, justly cause you to suffer. So for instance, if you identify as a Christian and you let everybody know that you're a Christian and you participate in a riot that leads to the taking of life and looting and all sorts of harm, you're going to be punished for it. People are going to speak ill of you, and you might be arrested and taken to court and convicted. Peter says, don't count that as unjust suffering. You're not suffering for Christ, you're suffering for your sins. If you act belligerently, don't complain that people are persecuting you because you are a Christian. They're persecuting you because you're a jerk. But if you suffer simply because you are a Christian, that's a different story. Look at verse 16. Yet if anyone suffers as a Christian, let him not be ashamed, but let him glorify God in that name. Our culture will often try to shame us for being Christians. They will say, well, you Christians, you're intolerant and you're silly and you have stupid beliefs and your standards of morality are way too strict. You need to get with the program. You're on the wrong side of history. People will mock us for what they think are silly things. They will hate us because they don't approve of certain socially accepted behaviors. And after a while, after the culture keeps bombarding us, we'll begin to wonder, do they have something there? Are we really that bad? Is what the Bible says really true? Should I just stop following Jesus and just go along with the flow? Peter warns us not to give in to that kind of thinking. You are blessed, and God is glorified when you suffer simply because you are a Christian, rather than caving in and try to ease the suffering. Brad, just recently in a devotional from Voice of the Martyrs of a pastor, no less, who was told that if he shot these two young girls who were Christians, if he shot them, he would be spared. And before he shot them, the girls said they forgave him. They were they thanked him for his ministry, and they hoped that he would experience forgiveness. And he shot them. And moments later, the authorities shot him. They didn't spare his life. He gained nothing by it. If we are truly suffering simply because we are living as God wills us to, then we are blessed. Verses 17 and 18 give us a good reason not to be ashamed of being a Christian and standing firm in our faith. These words are chilling when you think about them. Let them sink in. For it is time for judgment to begin at the household of God. And if it begins with us, what will be the outcome for those who do not obey the gospel of God? And if the righteous is scarcely saved, what will become of the ungodly and the sinner? Does that cause any concern? These are sobering verses to read. Judgment begins here, in the church, in the body of Christ. Now, there's ample evidence in the scriptures that Christians will be judged. We tend to think that, oh, you know, we're in Christ, we'll never be judged, everything is okay, we're good. And that's true as far as it goes. Our sins are covered by Christ. That's the good news. The good news is that we are judged according to our standing with Christ. If we are in Christ, we are indeed forgiven. If we have received him as our Lord and Savior, then he has absorbed our judgment. So he has already absorbed that judgment. So on judgment day, when the books are opened, God sees the list of our sins, which are many, at least for me. And he reads each of those sins. He writes down beside it, for those who are in Christ, not guilty. Not guilty. Not guilty. So the judgment has already been enacted on us. We're followers of Jesus Christ. The eschatological judgment, the judgment in the last day, has already been, we're already going through that. We have gone through that. I said that's good news, but it's not good news for everybody. It's only good news if we are standing with Christ. It's bad news. It's very bad news for those who don't belong to Christ. And when we read that judgment begins at the household of God, it ought to make us stop. Stop what we're doing and reflect. Am I in Christ? We can't assume that everybody in the church really is a follower of Jesus Christ. Some people might have a vague belief in Jesus, but they haven't surrendered their lives to him. Many people have put together their own designer religion with themselves at the center, and Jesus somewhere on the periphery, if he is even in the circle at all. And if Jesus is in the circle at all, they have a picture that they have created of Jesus as a nice, gentle young man who pats us on the head when we sin and says, that's no big deal. But it is a big deal. If we are not in Christ, if Jesus isn't in control of our lives, because when judgment comes, we're not covered by his blood. So when the fiery trial comes, those people will fall away. They will not have the Holy Spirit in them to help them persevere till the end. And the coming judgment will certainly expose them. And most chilling of all, if judgment begins at the household of God, what will it be like for those who do not obey the gospel of God? If the righteous barely escape the flames, what about the unrighteous? What hope do ungodly people and sinners have? And the answer is none. They can't rely on their good behavior, their good works, because they don't have enough of them to make up for sin. They have no hope. Only those who are in Christ will be able to stand in the final judgment. Not because they're righteous, because the truly righteous one died on their behalf and took the penalty, took the judgment, so that they wouldn't have to. So if God is testing his people when he allows them to suffer persecution from pagan hostility, what is our correct response? Peter tells us in verse 19, therefore, let those who suffer according to God's will entrust their souls to a faithful Creator while doing good. Entrust your souls to a faithful Creator while doing good. It's easy, isn't it, to entrust ourselves to God when things are going well, when life is good, when we're happy, when we're healthy, everything is going great. But Peter tells us, entrust yourselves to God. Trust this God who is allowing you to go through this trial, even when things are going bad. Even if you're suffering according to God's will. That is, don't suffer for being a murderer or a thief or an evildoer or a meddler. You see, we seem to think that when things are going well and things are good, that God knows what he's doing. Yeah, God, he's good, he's great, he's watching over me. But as soon as things go bad, then we begin to ask questions, don't we? Why is God doing this to me? Why is he allowing it? God isn't really good because he's allowing me to go through this. We question his character and his intentions. Peter says, don't do that. Entrust yourselves. When things are going bad, keep reminding yourself, God is good. God is good when he heals you of cancer. God is good when he chooses not to. God is good when he keeps that plane up in the air. He's even good when the plane crashes and you live through it. But he's also good when you don't. Trust yourself. This faithful Creator. Especially when you suffer for being a Christian. Because God does know what he's doing. And quite frankly, when we entrust ourselves to God in the face of unjust suffering, we are following in Jesus' footsteps. We are like Jesus. If you've been with us through this series, you might remember back in chapter 2, verse 21, Peter wrote, for to this you have been called as suffering, because Christ also suffered for you, leaving you an example so that you might follow in his steps. God intends for us to follow in Jesus' steps. And then in chapter 2, verse 23, he wrote, when he was reviled, Jesus, he did not revile in return. When he suffered, he did not threaten, but continued entrusting himself to him who judges justly. So God will judge us, he will judge our persecutors justly. That takes the responsibility off of us. We don't have to threaten other people who persecute us. We can take it and we can pray for them. Brothers and sisters, I think our own trial, our own fiery trial, may not be far off. Are you ready? Have you entrusted yourself to him who judges justly? Are you in Christ? Are you entrusting your soul to our faithful Creator so that you can stand firm against persecution and persevere through it? Are you willing to suffer with Christ so that you may be glorified with Christ? There's a saying that is written in a lot of gyms, a lot of workout areas for football teams and basketball teams and so on. No pain, no gain. And sometimes, maybe frequently, maybe always, that's true of Christianity. If we don't suffer with Christ, we don't get the glory with him. So you need to answer these questions for yourself so that when the fiery trial comes, you're ready and you can persevere. And you can see God's glory. Let's pray. Father, I have to admit that I am allergic to pain. I like to avoid it whenever possible. I want to medicate it. I want to avoid it. But I know that we live in a world where pain is everywhere, suffering is everywhere, persecution is everywhere. And I don't know, Lord, what the future will bring. You know, and you are preparing us for it. I pray that I will be ready. I pray that your people everywhere throughout this nation, throughout the world, will be ready for it. Strengthen us. Let your Holy Spirit fill us so that we have the strength to persevere through the fiery trials. O Lord, have mercy upon us. Strengthen us. We entrust ourselves to you, our faithful Creator. In the name of Jesus Christ. And in his name we pray the prayer that he taught his disciples. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
I don't think there's a more fitting song for us to close with than number 529, How Firm a Foundation. And just remember, brothers and sisters, that every promise that God has made is true. He has not failed in anything he has set his word to do. So know his promises, know that foundation as you face those trials so that you are ready to stand firm. We are going to be skipping verse number 3. That was changed since the PowerPoint was put together. So we will be singing 1, 2, 4, and 5 of number 529, How Firm a Foundation. Thank you.
after you have suffered for a little while, the God of all grace, who has called you to his eternal glory in Christ, will himself restore, confirm, strengthen, and establish you. To him be the dominion forever and ever. Amen.